Agatha always liked romance novels with a female protagonist who was like a ray of sunshine and a bright, friendly male protagonist. There was bound to be a dethroned prince of the North in the story, constantly tormenting them. But in these stories, the protagonist was sure to overcome all odds to win the love of the protagonist. Sometimes Agatha was disappointed with the characters in the book, so she decided to write her own story. Everything in her story will be perfect: the characters, the plot, and the dialogues. Agatha wrote her love story during recess in high school. Strange as it may seem, it was much easier for her to concentrate in the midst of the constant noise. And the main character of her novel was always in front of the girl's eyes. Agatha chose a handsome classmate as the prototype of her protagonist. He was ideal for the role of a romantic tempter and conqueror of women's hearts. Agatha drew inspiration for her book just by watching her classmate. He looked like a painting, even when he was just sitting there. "Agatha, why are you the one who keeps writing? I've noticed you've been watching the guys for a while now and making some notes. Are you drinking some nasty stuff about them?" Diana snatched the notebook from the girl's hands. "Christy, look at this. She's writing a novel. And look what a funny title." Diana showed her friend Agatha's notes. Bert came over to the girls and took Agatha's notebook from their hands. He examined it squeamishly. "Look at this. It's a novella. Why does it have such a long title? Are you the one writing the story?" Bert turned to Agatha. The girl stared at her classmate in silence. "Don't worry, I didn't read what I wrote. The only thing is, promise me you'll let me read your short story when you finish it," asked Bert to the girl. "I want to get closer to you in case you become a famous writer. Besides, we're childhood friends. Do you still remember that?" Agatha was embarrassed. She was embarrassed that her classmates had found out about her hobby. She promised herself that she would finish the story and prove to everyone that she was not an idle girl. Agatha had liked Bert for a long time. Their families had indeed been friends for many years, so the girl had known Bert from an early age. Agatha was afraid to confess her feelings to Bert. The girl thought he was too handsome. She was sure that the guy would reject her. 2 years later, Agatha decided to send her short story to a famous publishing house. The girl was lucky, and her story was published. "And why are you so surprised? Don't you know that your book is quite popular among our staff? Absolutely everyone in our company liked it. Everyone was impressed by your vivid writing style," said the girl to the editor of the publication. "Miss Shiverton, I invite you to begin writing your next novel. We promise that we will, in return, give you publicity and a generous advance. Have you decided on a prototype for the next protagonist?" The editor, Kimberly Swan, suggested that Agatha write the next novel with a rebellious and bully protagonist. Such stories were popular with the younger generation. Agatha never planned to write another book. The girl presented her debut novel as a confession. She described in it what really happened in her childhood years. She made her main character an exact copy of Bert. Agatha sent the written novel to Bert, as promised. Several months passed, but the boy never got around to reading it. Bert said he was busy. "I mean, he said he'd be sure to read my book when I was done. I've been working hard these past 2 years, but he never bothered to read it." Agatha thought to herself resentfully, "What if he didn't even want to read my novel, but said it out of politeness? I've promised myself several times that I'd forget that he was a childhood friend, but I keep coming back to him in my mind every time." In order not to think about Berta, Agatha took up writing a new novel. The girl decided that she would turn in the second book and break the contract with the publisher. She didn't plan to continue writing romance novels. "I hate to write a book about a negative protagonist, but it's not like I can tell an editor that I wrote my first novel because of a childhood friend. I said things in the book that I could never say to his face," Agatha thought as she walked home from the store. Agatha was worried about not being able to find the prototype of the main character for her new book. She couldn't completely invent a character and think out his character. Suddenly, Agatha heard a quarrel. She was curious, so she decided to watch what was going on. "If that's what you were going to do, so why have you been seeing me all this time?" the blonde questioned in a loud voice. The dark-haired guy admitted to her that he just needed a girl to appease his parents for a while. Suddenly, out of the blue, the blonde swung around and punched the guy in the face. "I was an idiot for trying to be nice to you, but you turned out to be a total rascal. Good luck staying alone," shouted the blonde, running away. So this girl just got dumped? Why did that person do that to her? By the way, that slap was very effective. I wish that guy would look at me. He'd be perfect for the role of the protagonist, Agatha thought to herself. The dark-haired guy felt that someone was watching him, so he turned around. He noticed a girl with glasses a little further away, peering around the corner. The dark-haired guy walked up to Agatha and didn't ask her why she was following strangers. "I saw absolutely nothing. I just walked up here. And I'm not following you. You just imagined it. I just heard screaming, and I was scared it might be domestic violence. I just wanted to help." Agatha started to justify herself. "I didn't hit anyone. If you had time to notice, I'm the one who got hit," said the dark-haired guy to Agatha. The more the girl watched him, the more she realized that he was just perfect for the role of the negative protagonist. "Please help me," Agatha asked unexpectedly. The girl decided not to miss her chance. She needed to talk to this man as long as possible to get to know his character in more detail. Agatha had to reveal that she was a writer and needed a prototype for her new character. "Don't get me wrong, but there are no people with a bad temper in my environment. I have absolutely no idea how I would describe the main character as a brute and a bully, but I think you're perfect for the role." "No." The boy was a little wordy. He didn't like that the girl had taken a glimpse of him and concluded that he had a bad temper and was rude. "But why? I really need your help. Don't refuse me." Agatha looked at the guy pleadingly. "What makes you think I should help you anyway? Maybe I don't want to do it. And judge the situation from my side. Some strange girl I've never seen before comes up to me and tells me I have a bad temper." Agatha noticed that this guy's mood changed almost every minute. Right now, he looked tired. Agatha realized that looking at him filled her with inspiration. She couldn't let him go. She wouldn't write her new book without him.
"I beg of you,"
Agatha exclaimed and grabbed the boy's arm. "If you help me, I'll pay you as models, of course. I'm broke right now, but as soon as I get the second installment of the advance, I'll be sure to pay you back." The guy irritably yanked his hand out of Agatha's grasp. "Forgive me, Miss Ryder, but you've most likely lost your grip on reality because of the genre you write in," menacingly whispered the dark-haired guy, leaning low over the girl. "If you keep acting like this, I'll call the police and have you taken to the station. Instead of harassing people on the street at night and saying ridiculous things to them, maybe you should spend that time reading books. Take inspiration from other authors." Agatha was supposed to turn in the outline of her new novel today, but she couldn't get the main character written. No matter how hard she tried, the character was kind and sympathetic. Agatha couldn't write a bad character for her protagonist. Agatha decided to stall for time for a while. She called Swan's editor and told her that she had been in a small accident and was now in the hospital. There was no need to visit her, as she only had minor bruises. As soon as she is well, she will continue writing the book. The girl editor was approached by her boss and asked her what was wrong. He noticed that the girl was extremely agitated about something. "One of our writers has had a sudden car accident. We're going to have to push back our publishing schedule for about a month. Our new writer says that once she recovers, she'll continue writing immediately. She's not badly hurt," Editor Swan told us. "You mean to tell me that the writer got off with minor bruises but can't continue writing? That sounds pretty ridiculous. Give me her phone number and I'll talk to her myself," answered the girl and her boss. "I'll see for myself if she's telling the truth or not. If she's not, then I'll have to get her out of the hospital and bring her here to write." Agatha was ashamed that she had to lie, but there was no other option. The girl couldn't write as she had absolutely no inspiration. "I hate to admit it, but I think that guy was right. I need to study some books related to my story. I think once I study all the negative characters from other authors, I'll definitely be able to think of a main character. Agatha got a message on her phone from Bert. The guy wrote that he was right in front of her house. He asked her to come out to him for a minute. Bert suggested that Agatha go to a small cafe near her house. When the girl came to the table, she saw Diana and Greg. Bert had been close friends with them during their school years. I heard you became a writer. I always thought you would be. Remember when you used to sit alone and write weird things in your notebook? Diana asked Agatha. They weren't weird. Anything published in my book with no age rating, my novella can be read by absolutely anyone. Smiling embarrassedly, Agatha replied. She felt awkward sitting at the same table with these people. They were not close friends at school. Looks like I'll have to read your book someday, though I'm so busy these days I don't even know if I'll have time to read something like that, Diana admitted. Bert suggested a drink to Agatha's new book. The girl cursed herself for sitting here instead of writing a new novel. Seeing Bert chatting animatedly with his friends, Agatha couldn't understand one thing. Why had he called her here? She decided to finish her drink and go home. Watching you, I realize that you haven't changed at all since high school. I've always wanted to ask you, what kind of relationship are you in? Diana asked unexpectedly. Why do you want to know that? Bert answered with a question. Agatha coughed in surprise. I thought you might be secretly dating Agatha, so you're constantly caring about her, but it doesn't seem that way to me now. The reason is because you like her, am I right? Diana decided to get to the bottom of this. We've been friends since we were kids, so we treat each other like brother and sister. Agatha replied to her former classmate. Diana, you have some unfounded assumptions. Agatha is telling the truth. Our parents are friends, so we actually grew up together. Any romantic relationship or feelings between us are out of the question. Bert hastened to assure Diana. Huh? A relationship between us? That even sounds funny. The thing is, I met Agatha's mom recently, and she asked if I would take her daughter out into the world. She's worried that her daughter's new book isn't working out. I'm just helping Agatha. Bert's laughter brought tears to his eyes. Our Bert was always a kind guy and helped the other kids at school. That's why you got it all wrong and confessed to him at the prom and he blew you off, said Greg to Diane. Hey, why are you suddenly remembering this? I mean, it was so long ago. And I told you not to mention it. You know, I don't have any feelings for Bert anymore, Diana shouted irritably. I rejected you then so that you and I could continue to be friends. If you and I had become a couple, we'd probably have broken up by now. Now, we continue to be friends and meet casually. I value our friendship, explained Bert to the girl. You've decided to continue to be friends only? You're not going to date anyone for the rest of your life? Diana asked Bert. You misunderstood me. That's not what I meant. One day, if someone I like comes along, I will definitely suggest that person to date. It's just that, until then, I haven't found a person who's right for me yet, Bert said thoughtfully. So I wrote that book for nothing. I'm probably not right for Bert, which is why he and I haven't met yet. And he never read my book, never understood how I felt about him. Agatha thought to herself with pain in her heart. Speaking of high school, I just remembered that you were writing some kind of book. What was the title of it? Isn't that the book that they decided to print? Asked Agatha Bert. You don't have to read it anymore, Agatha said offended and turned away from Bert. And I remembered what your first book was called. My Childhood Friend's Proposal, Diana said, crossing her arms over her chest. You were writing a story about childhood friends? The title came out kind of obscure, don't you think? Are modern books all like that? Bert asked, surprised. Don't read my book. I've changed my mind. I don't want you to know what it says, Agatha said to Bert. Herman, you've completely disappeared lately. Instead of working all the time, you should take a break once in a while. Look at the circles under your eyes, and you're always getting dumped by girls. The last one did it too. Darren grumbled resentfully. How do you know? I haven't told anyone anything, have I? Herman asked his buddy. He really didn't like it when someone prying into his private life. Of course I know. That girl was my subordinate, and I'm the one who introduced you. Darren exclaimed and slammed his fist irritably on the table. Why do you keep asking me to introduce you to someone if you hate dating and the very concept of marriage? My parents are pressuring me to get married. If I date someone, I can buy some time. When my parents see that I have a new girlfriend, they get behind me for a while, Herman explained. But don't you think it looks ridiculous? You read romance stories and then claim you hate romance. Do you have any idea what that looks like from the outside? Darren asked, noticing the mottled, bright, pink book in his friend's hands. This is one of the latest books released by our publishing company. It's quite popular, and I'm not reading it for pleasure but for work. Do you think it's easy being the director of a publishing company? Herman slammed his fist on the book irritably. I was wondering what kind of book could be written by a lying writer who wouldn't return my calls. After leaving the bar, Herman dialed the writer again, but she did not pick up the phone as before. The man heard some noise and shouting around the corner. Herman wondered what was going on there, so he went to the sound of the noise. And then it turns out she's married. I have absolutely no idea why my relationships keep ending like this, Greg exclaimed loudly. He was drunk, so he was acting rather boisterous. Why am I still here and not at home? Why did he think I was interested in his story? Agatha thought wistfully to herself. When Bert offered to have a beer, I immediately thought of you. I want to confess that I didn't like you in high school. But I remember you used to stare at me all the time because you liked me. You were always looking at me with lovey-dovey eyes, Greg went on to say. I didn't feel good about being rejected, but when I remembered that someone was so in love with me, I felt more confident, Greg admitted. Agatha remembered that Greg was always hanging around Bert. But what made him think she was looking at him in love? Listen, what's your name there? You spoke so enthusiastically that I didn't want to interrupt myself, but to tell you the truth, I wasn't looking at you. Agatha decided to tell her former classmate the truth, so he wouldn't drown in pointless fantasies. Don't be stupid, you were definitely staring at me. I exposed myself to you, and you're saying something completely different. Greg shouted loudly, which startled the girl. Look, I keep forgetting your name, so what makes you think I like you? And why would I lie to you if I'm in love with you? I don't understand what you want from me at all. The girl objected to Greg. Agatha was afraid that he wouldn't hold back and would end up hitting her. Right outside the mall, a drunk man is making a mess. It looks like he's going to hit his girlfriend. I think you should hurry, said Herman into the receiver of the phone. Greg and Agatha stared at Herman in surprise.
Hey, what do you want, mister? Were you just talking about me? What makes you think that's my girlfriend anyway? Greg asked irritably.
Did I make a mistake? Someone mentioned domestic violence recently. I just assumed that's what it was about. A person wouldn't just be afraid of domestic violence if they're far from it, Herman explained.
And why don't you leave before you do something you'll regret later? I think your girlfriend is pretty scared, said Herman to Greg.
You got it wrong again. I don't have a girlfriend. And why do you even care about any of this, mister? Greg asked Herman, walking up close to him. Greg patted the man's chest warningly.
I asked you not to do something you'll regret later, Herman said with a sidelong glance and pushed Greg's hand away from him.
Greg realized that the man was dangerous, so he hurried away. Besides, if the police arrived now, he'd be in a lot of trouble. I'm not his girlfriend, and we haven't been on a date, but thanks for helping me out anyway. Would you like me to give you a gift card or something to thank you? Asked Agatha.
What's going on now? Doesn't this girl recognize me? Herman thought in surprise.
Without a word, Herman turned away from the girl and headed toward his car. He would never see her again, so why should he communicate with her?
Agatha called out to the man, then caught up to him and grabbed his arm.
I noticed the book in your hands. If you carry it around with you, you probably like it. It's a little embarrassing to say this, but for your help, I can sign the book if you'd like, Agatha offered. Herman perplexedly showed the girl the book. He had not expected that tonight he would still be able to find the writer.
I am honored to meet the author of such a wonderful book. I called you throughout the day, but you didn't answer me. Let me introduce myself. My name is Herman Gerbent, and I'm the director of Success Publishing. Agatha was sitting in front of the director of the publishing house that published her book, and she was embarrassed that she had lied about going to the hospital. When you reported your injury to Editor Swan, my heart just dropped. On top of that, you weren't returning my calls, which seemed very suspicious. But now I see you're okay, so I'll get right to the point. When is the next manuscript due?
I'll be honest with you, too. I'm not sure I can write another novella,
Agatha admitted. Herman seemed less scary to her this time than last time. He had been more aggressive then.
Is this some kind of game to you?
Herman suddenly burst out.
I'll try to write a book, but I need more time for that.
Agatha hastened to smooth things over.
But you've already put it off for weeks. How much more time do you need?
Herman asked in a calmer voice. When I signed on with Editor Swan, she told me that if I ever wanted to take a break, I could do so at any time. Noted Agatha.
She meant if something serious happens or you get really sick. At the moment, you're all right. You're not even sick.
Herman objected to the girl. Give me 2 months, please. I think that will be enough for me, Agatha asked.
Herman had no time to listen to this nonsense. It was necessary to release the next book as soon as possible while her debut story was in demand. If they delayed, the young writer would be quickly forgotten. What a disappointment! I had a better opinion of Editor Swan. Did she give the authors false information that could be considered a disciplinary offense? Herman knew that Agatha and Editor Swan were friends, so with the help of his friend, he wanted to put pressure on the writer. To give one author a break, she's allowing the company to suffer losses and forcing me to do extra work. Hence, I will punish her, Herman said angrily and broke a chopstick in half. Wait a minute. I don't want Kimberly to get hurt because of me. There's actually a reason why I can't write the next novel. It's all about you, Mr. Director. Embarrassed, Agatha muttered.
And why is it suddenly my fault? Herman wondered.
You told me to stop writing books after I overheard you talking to that girl. So since that day, I haven't been able to write a line, Agatha confessed.
God, she's so difficult. I told her to take inspiration from other writers. I didn't say anything about her giving up writing. I guess she wasn't lying to me when she said she couldn't write without a prototype.
Herman thought irritably.
We're on a tight schedule at the publishing house. We can't give her a couple months to think about it. I'm already tired of dealing with problems, and she keeps throwing new ones at me.
When we first met, you said you needed a prototype. If you have one, can you finish the manuscript?
Herman asked the girl.
You're right. Right now I'm laboring to gather material, so if you give me a month or two, I'll finish the manuscript,
Agatha promised.
You don't need to spend your time looking for material. If what you need to start writing is a prototype of your hero, then I suggest you turn your attention to a real person, said Herman, hovering over the girl.
Herman looked intently into Agatha's eyes and slowly loosened his tie. Right in front of you is the perfect prototype for a book. You told me so yourself. I'll take you up on your offer.
Am I understanding him correctly? Did this man just offer me to be the model for my next book?
Agatha thought in surprise. Suddenly, Agatha laughed,
involuntarily looking coffee right into the publishing director's face.
Oh, I'm sorry about that. I'm so sorry.
You just offered to model for me so unexpectedly that I couldn't contain my emotions. I'll clean this up real quick right now,
Agatha exclaimed.
That's okay. It's late, so let's call it a night. I came here by car so I can give you a ride home,
Herman said in a calm voice, but there was a wild irritation in his eyes. Agatha hurriedly agreed to the principal's proposal. She was afraid to be under the gaze of his gray eyes. Agatha herself didn't notice how she found herself in Herman's car. She found it hard to believe that this man had agreed to be the prototype for her book. Agatha glanced at Herman. The man was angry and irritated. Agatha realized that under such pressure, she was unlikely to be inspired. Suddenly, Herman approached the girl.
Agatha was afraid that the man would start hitting on her, so she slapped Herman sharply across the face.
We can't do that.
As much as I need inspiration for a book, you don't need to go that far. By the way, I want to warn you that I already like one person.
Agatha shouted loudly. I actually reached for my seatbelt. You hadn't buckled up in a long time, so I decided to help you, but I'm already regretting it, Herman said to the girl, rubbing the bruised spot.
Agatha turned away to the window so that Herman would not see her face burning with shame. The girl was behaving very strangely and clumsily today, and she was ashamed of herself.
And how were you able to write your first novel? You said you couldn't write without a prototype, even though you got a pretty well-developed character, said Herman to break the awkward silence.
Well, she just wrote it.
Dropping her eyes to the floor, Agatha said, she didn't want to tell the principal about Berta. She'd said too much today.
Was the prototype the guy you like? Herman asked.
How did you know? Agatha involuntarily grasped Herman's shoulder. From fright, Herman let go of the steering wheel for a moment. The car began to swerve from side to side. Herman had to stop the car to come to his senses. He was literally pounding with irritation.
I'm sorry, I couldn't control my emotions, Agatha muttered.
Yeah, you've been apologizing since the moment we met, but you still keep creating ridiculous situations that you have to apologize for. Are you doing this on purpose? Herman growled angrily. He gripped the steering wheel so tightly that his knuckles turned white.
I'm not doing all this on purpose. I'm sorry. I was just really surprised.
Yes, I wrote my first novel using a guy I liked as a prototype for the main character. I originally wrote this novel to confess my feelings to him.
What has a novel got to do with a declaration of love? Herman asked, perplexed.
In that story, I included a lot of what actually happened between us. I only changed the details a little, so after reading it, he should have realized what I was talking about. I wrote the novel because I was afraid he would reject me if I said all that out loud.
But it was all for nothing, because it's unlikely he'll ever read my book. And I want to assure you that everything that happened before, I didn't do it on purpose.
Tears ran down Agatha's cheeks. Everything that had happened this evening was extremely upsetting.
And I liked your book. I just finished it before I met you. I was immersed in the tale of an ordinary girl who changes completely around a childhood friend. Your book is steeped in reality, and I'm glad you let me into your illusory dream.
I like you as a writer, because you write such detailed descriptions. Your book is easy to read. You can dive into it. It lets you relax and get as far away from all your worries as possible.
Herman looked carefully into the girl's eyes. And about the guy you like that you mentioned earlier, wouldn't he be interested in your books himself if you became famous?
Honestly, not many people look at the author before choosing a book.
Of course, if you want that guy to pay attention to you, your new book has to succeed.
Okay, you talked me into it. I'll write a book in no time, but you'll be my prototype. I think I can make it work.
Agatha liked the principal's idea. She would become famous and get Bert's attention.
Agatha got out of Herman's car and thanked him for giving her a ride home.
Suddenly, someone called the girl's name. Agatha turned her head and saw Bert. Seeing Agatha's worried face, Herman realized that the protagonist of the writer's debut novel was standing in front of him.
Miss Ryder, I have something to tell you. Please bend over a little, whispered Herman in the girl's ear.
I want to tell you that this kid is absolutely nothing like the main character.
What are you talking about? Come on, get out of here soon,
Agatha exclaimed indignantly.
All right, I'm off. But let's try together on your next novel, and don't forget to answer my calls.
Herman said to the girl and shrieked the rubber on the asphalt and took off.
When the guys asked if I was really your boyfriend, I wondered if you had someone in your life that you liked. I thought you were inexperienced with dating.
I want to tell you that dating guys through apps is not the way to go, said Bert to the girl.
I never thought you'd act like this, so I'm pretty disappointed in you. I thought you'd never get into a car with a man you didn't know.
The writer described the main character as a very kind, gentle, and smiling guy. Looking at this blonde guy, I would never have thought he had those qualities. It seems to me that Miss Ryder is badly mistaken, thought to himself Herman.
And what do you mean by applications?
Agatha was puzzled. She had no idea what Bert was talking about. I've only heard of people using them, but I couldn't think of you resorting to them as well. I want to warn you that you get some really weird people on these apps who might look normal. Bert was uncomfortable with this conversation. I mean to say that knowing you and knowing your absent-mindedness, you could fall prey to scammers. Such people see your kind as easy prey. Easy prey like me? What do you think I did? Agatha tried to understand why Bert was having this whole conversation. I want to tell you that even if others do this kind of thing, you shouldn't touch it. I really didn't want to say that, said Bert to the girl, taking her hand. As she touched Bert's palm, Agatha lost touch with reality. The characters of her book appeared before the girl's eyes. The main character always worried about being the only one for his beloved. Looking into Bert's eyes, Agatha expected him to declare his love. After all, her book ended with the protagonist finally pulling himself together and confessing his feelings to his childhood friend. And if he does confess his love to me now, what am I supposed to do about it? Agatha thought fearfully. I don't want to be the only one left. Agatha heard Bert's voice as she came back to reality. Everyone around here is dating and everything. I somehow believed that at least you, my childhood friend, weren't interested. Now you're making me feel left out. What is he talking about now? I'm so interested in dating that I even wrote a whole novel to confess my feelings to someone I like, Agatha thought to herself as she listened to Bert's monologue. That's enough. I don't do anything in apps and stuff like that. This man who gave me a ride is the director of my publishing company. We had a business meeting tonight, Agatha said in a calm, unemotional voice. I had completely forgotten about that. I thought you told me you were a writer. I mean, you even wrote a book, Bert exclaimed. Agatha was unpleasantly surprised that Bert had forgotten that she was a writer. He probably didn't remember that he'd wanted to read her book a long time ago, either. I can see in your eyes that you are disappointed in me. Are you really mad at me? Bert asked, grabbing the girl by the shoulders. I want to tell you that when you get angry, you look ugly. So stop being angry. It doesn't do you any good. I know what I need to do to make you ask for me. I should just read your book. You probably have a copy of your book at home, so let's go over to your place and I'll read your novel. You remember we used to visit each other a lot to hang out together. Agatha agreed to have Bert read the book at her house, but not today, but some other day. This will be the first time we've been alone in my house since we were in high school. In short, I finally have an opportunity. This chance can't be let go. It must be seized, Agatha thought to herself. The girl remembered that Bert was constantly surrounded by female classmates. All those girls knew how to dress up. Agatha wore only comfortable clothes all the time. She never thought about her appearance. That's why Bert decided I wasn't interested in dating. Right. From the beginning, the problem wasn't that he didn't read the book. It was me. I need to change my appearance. Agatha didn't like her reflection in the mirror. Miss, your phone keeps ringing, and it looks like you've gotten a bunch of messages since you came here, said the girl hairdresser to Agatha. Ignore it, or better yet, turn it off, asked Agatha of the girl. Herman was extremely angry with the writer Agatha Shiverton. She did not pick up the phone again and did not answer his messages. Editor Swan came up to Herman and handed him her report. I want to warn you that from this day forward, I will take care of the work of author Agatha Shiverton myself. If I leave it to you, the novel won't come out before I die. Besides, you're the one who asked me to reduce the number of writers you're responsible for. I'll go in search of the writer right away. I understand she can't be left without close supervision. Herman drove up to the writer's house and dialed her telephone number. Suddenly, a melody played behind him. Turning around, Herman saw the writer. Agatha also noticed the director near her house. The girl ran away. Herman caught the girl and pressed her against the wall. He decided not to hide his irritation. And why are you trying to run away from me now? And why aren't you picking up the phone? If I hadn't come here, would you have disappeared again? Herman asked irritably. No, what makes you say that? If you give me a little more time, I'll get you the manuscript. I've even been leaving the house with my laptop lately. I write every chance I get.
said Agatha, looking somewhere off to the side. Herman was surprised that the girl was deliberately avoiding his gaze.
If you're going to explain yourself, at least look me in the eye. You're being extremely rude right now, Herman said, and took her cap off the girl's head.
Herman froze in surprise. The writer's head was adorned with a mop of red curls.
If you didn't want to show up looking like that, you should have taken my calls. Even if you were at the hairdresser or the manicurist, said Herman to the girl.
Suddenly, the man laughed out loud.
He was amused by the new image of the writer. With a swirl of curls on her head, the girl looked extremely funny.
Stop laughing at me. I don't see anything funny about my hair, Agatha exclaimed and put her cap back on.
Miss Writer, I would never make fun of you if you had a perm or a bald spot, so there's no need to exaggerate. Honestly, I don't understand why you suddenly decided to change your haircut, Herman said to the girl in a serious tone.
By the way, your new haircut isn't so bad. The more I look at it, the more I like it.
I changed my style a little to please the friend I was telling you about. Do you really think this hairstyle looks good on me? Asked a blushing Agatha.
Why are you talking about guys now when you don't even have time to finish your work? You even missed the deadline, so you can hardly finish the manuscript now.
Herman didn't like the fact that the writer was getting fancy for his friend. Like I said last time, the fastest way to get noticed is to become a famous writer. Going to the hairdresser and changing your appearance is a waste of time and money.
And stop staring at me so surprised you'd rather stare at your laptop monitor screen. I need you to finish the manuscript as soon as possible.
Agatha drummed irritably on the keyboard of her laptop. She had set herself the goal of finishing the manuscript now. Sometime later, Agatha handed Herman the completed work. Still, finding you a prototype was the right decision. It turned out well. I liked the way you wrote it, Herman said with a smile on his face.
Agatha was surprised that Herman not only smiled at her, but praised her for a job well done.
Agatha looked at the director with different eyes. The man was now inspiring her to write a new story. But nothing had changed. He'd just put on his glasses.
He wore glasses, and I wear glasses. Maybe that's why I reacted differently to him now. I should probably get myself some contact lenses, Agatha thought, looking at her reflection in the glass.
I have no idea what goes on in that girl's head. I've seen a lot of different writers, but she's a very strange woman, Herman thought to himself as he took off his glasses.
Bert was supposed to go to a cafe with Agatha today, but at the last minute, the girl canceled the meeting. Bert decided not to waste time, but to go for a walk around the city himself. As he passed the cafe, he noticed Agatha in the window. The boy froze on the spot in surprise. Agatha shuddered and turned away from the window. Herman looked at the girl in surprise. The man did not understand what could have frightened her so much.
I have to go to the restroom. I'll be right back,
said Agatha and ran towards the ladies' room.
Agatha, what are you doing here?
Bert, who had appeared behind the girl, asked in surprise.
You have me confused with someone else, Agatha said, adding a huskiness to her voice. Forgive me, I really thought I knew you,
Bert muttered incredulously.
I noticed your voice is too hoarse. You must be very sick. Maybe you should see a doctor, Bert asked the girl.
What took you so long? Asked Herman, who appeared in the hallway. The man noticed that Agatha was not alone, but her childhood friend was standing next to her. Bert stared at the dark-haired man as he approached. He had definitely seen him before, but he couldn't remember where. Agatha ran up to the principal and tried to push him out of the hallway. If he kept talking to her, Bert would realize who was in front of him, as Herman did not move from his seat. Agatha hugged him tightly and buried her face in his chest.
Sir, let's get out of here, please. I don't want him to see me like this,
Agatha whispered, looking into the principal's eyes. Agatha could feel the headmaster trembling with anger. Of course, the girl was scared and embarrassed, but she couldn't let Bert see her ruined hair.
You'll have to pay me back for this. Be sure of that,
Herman whispered and squeezed the girl's shoulders tightly.
Honey, since you've already washed your hands, let's get out of here. You were in such a hurry to go about your business. You look a little pale, so if it's hard for you to walk, I can carry you in my arms.
With a slight smile on his face in a soft voice,
Herman said. Herman took Agatha's hand and led her toward the main exit. I hate being involved in other people's business. It's second on the list of things I hate. At number one are writers who miss deadlines and don't return my calls, reprimanded writer Herman. Solve your problems on your own and stop dragging me into them. Look at what you made me do. I'm so sorry. I was just worried that you would accidentally call me by my name, but I'm truly grateful to you for helping me, Agatha said to Herman. Now do you realize that you owe me? You must send me all manuscripts on time, Herman said in a serious tone. Suddenly, Herman's cell phone rang. It was his mother calling. Herman realized that if he picked up the phone, he would have to answer questions about his marriage again. Miss Ryder, I helped you today, so you help me too. Come with me somewhere for a little while, said Herman to the girl. Herman decided to take Agatha to a beauty salon in the city center. It was necessary to put on makeup and tidy up her hair. I've noticed that makeup looks good on plain faces. Also, a lot depends on what the person is wearing, said the girl stylist to Agatha. You've gotten so cute. Just look at your boyfriend. He's speechless with surprise. Only after leaving the beauty parlor, Agatha asked Herman where they were going. I told you that you need to go somewhere with me now, and that's where we're going. Without taking his eyes off the phone, Herman said. Suddenly, the man stopped and touched Agatha's hair. Herman told the writer that today he wanted to enjoy her beauty as long as possible. A few days earlier, Darren had confided to his buddy that he was very jealous of him. First, he had a good position, and second, he was constantly surrounded by beautiful women. And if you don't want to get married, tell your mother directly. I'm sick of hearing you whine all the time, Darren told his buddy in a disgruntled voice. If it were that easy, do you think I'd be sitting here getting all this stress? Herman asked his friend. And you look at yourself. You're working too hard. I understand how your mother feels. She's worried that her only son doesn't have a girlfriend and is married to his job. You at least pretend to be interested in getting married, advised Darren. I think you should start dating someone. Pretend you're head over heels in love with a girl, then announce your breakup and pine for her defiantly. Seeing you in pain will make your mother change her mind about marrying you. You should find a girl who agrees to play the part of your bride. I like your idea, but I'm not sure there's anyone who would be willing to do something like that, Herman said thoughtfully. You kept asking, so I want to introduce you to the woman I'm dating at the moment, Herman said, and pulled Agatha tightly against him. I didn't expect you to be seeing someone already. You've only recently broken up with Rose. Mrs. Gerbent was surprised. Agatha is exactly the kind of girl who made a workaholic like me look at my life with different eyes. I brought this girl here to show you the seriousness of my intentions, said Herman, and kissed Agatha's hand. I'm glad I met a girl like Agatha. I plan to marry her soon. Don't you think you're rushing things too much? Mrs. Gerbent asked, irritably. A blushing Agatha looked at Mrs. Gerbent for the first time that evening. An hour earlier, Herman had asked the girl to pretend to be his lover. The only thing is, I need you to behave in a way that makes you seem insufferable to my mother, asked the girl Herman. When Agatha saw Mrs. Gerbent, she knew she didn't like the woman at first sight. She didn't even have to do anything. Mrs. Gerbent thought she was not a suitable candidate to be her son's wife. Well, Miss Shiverton, what do you do? Crossing her arms over her chest, Mrs. Gerbent asked. I work from home. I'm a writer, Agatha replied with a smile. If it's because of that past woman, I mean, if you're rebelling because of what happened then, I don't like it. Mrs. Herbert turned to her son. This has nothing to do with the case. Please don't bring up the past. It makes everything awkward, looking furtively asked Herman's mother. All right, let's not talk about that incident. Only I want to tell you that the writer is not fit to be a future wife. Mrs. Herbert looked as if she herself was uncomfortable with the recollection of the past. Listening to the director's conversation with her mother, Agatha concluded that he had met a writer before, and their communication had ended sadly. Agatha knew that many writers remain lonely. It is hard for them to find someone who accepts them for who they are. Dear son, you know that one of our acquaintances married a writer, but they did not agree and soon divorced. You're a busy man. You need a woman who can support you in your time of need. This girl can't do that. Even though Agatha was only playing the part of the bride, she still felt bad that Herman's mother didn't think she was ready for a serious relationship. Just because she's a writer doesn't mean she's a winded lady. Yes, she is indeed a bit clumsy, but that's her only vice.
What's wrong with me? Asked Agatha loudly, crunching an ice cube.
Agatha remembered the villain from her novel. To create the image of this girl, Agatha read several books on psychology. As a writer, she knew very well what it was like to be unbearable.
I can't understand. Are writers not allowed to date or something? Agatha asked in a calm and firm voice.
And I'm not sure Principal Herbert could find anyone willing to go out with him but me, said Agatha and laughed loudly. Herman had wanted to end the whole marriage story smoothly and without scandal, but now he felt hurt.
Agatha grabbed Herman by the tie and pulled him to her. What the hell are you doing now? What's wrong with you?
Herman whispered in surprise. He had lost control of the situation, and it annoyed him greatly.
You remember, because I haven't answered your question yet. You asked if I would date you to marry you later. Since your mother is here, let's tell her straight.
Looking intently into Herman's eyes, Agatha said,
We agreed that we would see each other for a while and then get married. Do you really want to change our agreement?
Since Herman was silent, Agatha had to let go of his tie. Unfortunately, the girl had not thought of what she should do next. Now she looked hesitantly into Herman's eyes.
I'll help you now, whispered Herman, rising from his seat.
Mom, I just got an emergency call from the company. I have to go back to the office right now. I promise you that we will continue our conversation a little later. We'll make time and visit you at home.
Bert decided to take a walk around town before going to bed. He was looking for someone among his acquaintances who would agree to have a few beers with him. Suddenly, Bert's gaze stopped on a pair of lovers. He recognized the man immediately. A few days ago, they had bumped into each other in the hallway near the restroom. The girl seemed extremely familiar to Bert.
When you get angry so suddenly, it confuses me, Agatha exclaimed.
But thanks to that, we were able to get out of there, weren't we? And actually, I'm the one who should be outraged right now. What the hell were you doing back there in the first place? Why did you grab me by my tie? Herman asked the girl. You asked me to do my best to displease your mother. I was playing the character of a villain who provokes her dear son. Agatha replied in a resentful tone. Suddenly, Agatha hid behind Herman's back. It seemed to her that someone was looking at her intently.
And who do you think is going to stare at you, Miss Ryder? You're just being overly cautious. You have an overactive imagination, said Herman, turning to the girl.
But my instincts never lie, Agatha whispered fearfully.
Herman took off his jacket and put it on the girl. He suggested that we go to a small restaurant for dinner.
I remember now that I didn't eat anything this afternoon. Today was such a busy day that I didn't even realize I was hungry. And it's doubly nice to know that you're the one paying for dinner. Agatha exclaimed happily, eating one dish after another.
Herman watched the girl dejectedly. He offered to pay her bill out of politeness. The man did not expect her to agree.
Are you sure you don't want to eat anything else?
Look, I can eat it all by myself, Agatha warned.
I'm surprised at how quickly you've gotten into the villain role after all. You now look like a person I've never met before. Back then at the cafe, your look changed drastically. I didn't expect you to be such a good actress,
praised the girl Herman. I tried to create an unlikable character who says horrible things. To do this, I remembered the days when I used to write short love stories for social media. At that time, I used to get a lot of mean comments about my work.
Narrated Agatha. Commentaries are often violent, but stories need a villain. It makes them lively and engaging. Herman quipped.
I want to give you some advice. Write your books the way you want to write them. Don't pay attention to the comments. If you do a good job, I'll treat you to a barbecue now and then.
The concept is a little different this time around, but the atmosphere came out just right. Unlike the last book,
I feel like I'm the main character when reading it. Kimberly praised the young writer Agatha. I want to point out that it's not just the writing style that has changed, but the energy you're exploring. I guess my look probably looks a little weird, but I've been getting into style lately. I'm curious about what's in fashion right now, replied a blushing Agatha. To avoid embarrassing her friend, she put on a jacket.
Are you going out after we meet? You just look like you're going on a date. Did this man have anything to do with changing the atmosphere of your manuscript? Kimberly asked.
You misunderstood me. I just decided to change my style of dressing. And as for the main character, I just managed to find a suitable prototype. You know I'm not dating anyone at the moment.
Agatha didn't want to admit to her friend that her dressing style had changed, thanks to Principal Herbent. It was he who told her that her hair and style suited her.
All right, I've got to go. I really hope this book is even more successful than the last one. I don't know who your prototype is, but I guess I should thank him for his help, said Kimberly and stashed her tablet in her bag.
And how is Principal Gearbent? Agatha asked. She needed to give Herman his jacket.
I don't know why you're asking about him, but I just want to point out that it's extremely rare to catch him in the office lately, replied Kimberly to her friend.
He comes to the office if he has an important meeting or something. To be honest, I haven't seen him in days.
After meeting Kimberly, Agatha went to the university where Bert was studying. They had arranged to meet today, but Kimberly didn't need to know about it. In the crowd of students, Agatha spotted Bert. He looked as gorgeous as ever. Herman decided to work at home because his mother, after that meeting, visited him every day. The woman was worried that her son would marry that strange writer and ruin his life. It's just useless to explain anything to my mother now. She won't believe now that it was only an act of publicity. Herman thought with a heavy sigh. The phone on Herman's coffee table began to play again. The man trembled fearfully. It was his mother again. Herman decided not to answer the phone. Looking at his phone, Herman thought about the fact that he hadn't spoken to the writer in a long time. Should he call her, or would she call him herself if she needed him? Suddenly, Herman heard the doorbell ring. The man went to the intercom to see who had come to see him. Bert glimpsed Agatha and walked past.
Didn't he recognize me? Agatha thought in surprise.
Excuse me, but I think I've seen you somewhere before, said Greg, who approached the girl. He didn't recognize her either.
You may think I'm weird, but could you leave your phone number?
Hey, why are you hanging out here? We were supposed to go to the cafeteria with you.
Diane walked up to Greg. Diana glimpsed Agatha.
You couldn't find a girl from our faculty, so now you're looking for her in other faculties?
Diana asked Greg.
If you don't want to give your phone number, come here more often. If you want, we can go to the coffee shop with you after class, Greg suggested.
Chill out. A girl like that already has a boyfriend. I saw them together outside a little restaurant the other day, by the way, said Bert, who had approached the group of friends.
I think I've seen this girl somewhere before, too, Diana said, continuing to stare at Agatha.
Well, this is the first time I've seen all of you. I'm actually busy, so I better go, Agatha exclaimed with a slight change in her voice.
And I recognize you. Is it really you?
Then it's possible to change beyond recognition with makeup and different clothes, Bert whispered in Agatha's ear.
You look wonderful. Quite a different person, miss. I was so surprised to see you in the street with that man. You looked really good. I even thought your boyfriend was cheating on you.
Looking at Bert, Agatha had absolutely no idea what he was talking about right now. What's her boyfriend? Who's cheating on who? And why was he being so polite to her anyway?
I recognized you from your bag. We first ran into you in the hallway outside the restroom. You were still wearing your hat. And then I saw you and your boyfriend outside the restaurant.
Bert explained to the surprised girl.
You really don't recognize me? This already seems pretty rude. It's even getting on my nerves.
After getting rid of Bert, Agatha walked to the public transportation stop. She still couldn't believe that her former classmates didn't recognize her.
I shouldn't have come here. Now Bert knows me as a woman who flaunts her relationship.
I won't be able to show myself in front of him like this again, Agatha thought as she took off her wig. I wonder if I should tell Bert that the woman at the restaurant was me, or should I keep it to myself?
And should I tell Principal Girbant what happened? Maybe he'll say I'm behaving inappropriately. Stepping out onto the landing, Herman saw a young red-haired girl.
Look, I just recently moved here. I'm going to live here now, down the hall. I'm recently divorced, and I have absolutely no friends in this neighborhood.
I thought we could be friends, said the red-haired girl to Herman.
After talking to the neighbors, I found out that you live all alone.
The red-haired girl tried to get a glimpse of the furnishings in Herman's apartment. She wondered if there were women's or children's things in the hallway.
Don't worry about me, I'm fine. I have someone to be friends with and socialize with, replied Herman to the girl.
Suddenly, Herman heard a loud sigh. Turning his head to the right, he saw Agatha.
I'll tell you again. I don't need a friend. I have someone to be friends with. And I also want to warn you that my girlfriend is quite jealous,
said Herman to the red-haired neighbor and pushed Agatha into his apartment.
Miss Ryder, about what I just said, I was joking. I had to say we were dating.
Herman began to justify himself.
Well, you won't eventually ask me to date you, will you?
Agatha clarified.
That's how it happened. Don't worry, I won't ask you to date me. I'm just covering for you at the right moments for me.
Herman finished his story. In all the fuss, I forgot to ask you the main question. Why did you come to see me? Herman noticed that the girl was silent, listening attentively to him, and this frightened him extremely.
Well, that's great, isn't it? Meeting the divorced neighbor. I need to write it all down before the inspiration fades. We're going to make the divorced neighbor a runaway empress,
Agatha exclaimed and reached into her bag for her laptop.
You came all the way to my house to write a new novel? Did you come to me because I promised to be your prototype?
Herman asked irritably.
I actually came to you to return this, Agatha said and started rummaging through her huge bag again. I brought you your jacket. It smelled like barbecue, so I had it dry cleaned. I wanted to warn you about my visit, but you didn't answer my phone calls.
Agatha finally pulled a small black bag out of her bag.
I don't need it, so take it for yourself and go away.
In an emotionless voice, Herman said to the girl, And why are you reacting like that? That jacket looks expensive. Don't you want to wear it anymore? Agatha wondered.
But that's not all. I brought food and drinks with me. Editor Swan told me you've been working from home lately and you look very pale.
Agatha set the red fish and sweet drinks on the table.
You know that salmon is good for skin color. Director, you have circles under your eyes like you're about to become a panda. Hurry up and eat this.
Herman gave in under the girl's pressure. He took the fish from her hands and went to the kitchen to cook it. Agatha had a cunning plan. She wanted to feed the director first so that he would be in good spirits and then ask him for a favor. She needed him to tell Bert in person that they were not dating, that they had a purely business relationship.
It turns out the director knows how to cook. Every time I notice new positive qualities in him, I wonder why he still doesn't have a girlfriend,
Agatha thought as she watched the director working in the kitchen. Surprisingly, the fish Herman had prepared was very tasty. The last time Agatha had eaten such delicious salmon was in a restaurant. If you write good books, I'm willing to cook for you on a regular basis. I consider it an extremely favorable deal. For the sake of good novels, I'm ready to fulfill any request of yours, Herman assured the girl.
Can I really ask you for help now? Agatha clarified.
The girl was glad that Herman himself had suggested it. Now it would be easier for her to explain her request to him.
And what makes you doubt my words? I told you that you can ask me for anything you want. Just first, let me see what you've already written, asked the girl Herman.
Yes, sure, look. But this is just a rough sketch. It's a passage I'll still be working on. While I was watching you cook, I managed to flesh out the character of the main character, narrated Agatha.
Herman didn't like that the girl made the main character the chef of a small restaurant. He ordered that chapter to be redone.
I put up with you staring at me while I was cooking because I thought I was helping you write, but I got this as a result, Herman resented.
Agatha reached out to take her laptop from Herman's hands, but it slipped out of the man's hands and fell to the floor.
My laptop!
Agatha exclaimed fearfully.
Miss Shiverton, I'm very sorry this happened. I really hope nothing happened to him, said Herman to the girl. Fortunately, the laptop was not damaged. There was only a small dent in the screen in one place.
Since it's my fault, I'll take responsibility and subdue him.
Herman began looking in his phone book for the number of a handyman who repaired laptops and computers.
I promise to forget about it and repair the laptop myself if you fulfill one request of mine. To tell you the truth, I came here to ask you something.
In a quiet voice, a little embarrassed, Agatha said,
Please go and see my friend and clear up any misunderstandings that have arisen, asked Agatha.
I can't believe I purposely went out before the lunch break and even moved the meeting to come here. I never thought I'd have to wait for over an hour.
Herman thought to himself irritably, I should write that I'm going to be late. After the laptop is fixed, I need to meet a writer friend.
Herman realized that he had embarrassed the girl. She was right. He should explain to her friend that there had been a misunderstanding. This girl should not suffer because he asked her to play along with him in front of his mother.
Agatha was upset that Principal Gerbent was late. It was lunchtime at the university, so that was the time when Bert could be found in the cafe. If the principal didn't show up on time, Bert would have to look elsewhere.
Agatha rose from the table. In her heart, she was glad that her explanation to Bert would be postponed. Agatha didn't know how he would react to her revelations, whether he would believe her.
So, we meet again. May I sit here? Don't you think it's strange that you and I have been seeing too much of each other lately? Asked the girl as Bert approached.
I'm really into sweets. I'm graduating this year, so I have a lot of stress. To calm down, I eat desserts a lot, Bert told the girl.
You probably have a favorite dessert? Can you recommend me something delicious?
Asked Agatha to the guy. Of course, the girl wanted to ask slightly different questions, but decided to start with desserts.
I'll name you a delicious dessert so you can try it with your boyfriend later, Bert asked.
To be honest, I haven't seen him since that day. He and I haven't been seeing each other lately, Agatha replied.
So you had a fight with your boyfriend? Is that why you're sitting here alone?
Diana was annoyed that Bert wasn't answering her phone calls, so she practically kept her eyes on her feet. Suddenly, she bumped into a tall man. In front of Diana stood an irritated Herman. He had already spent half an hour in the sun, so he had to take off his jacket and loosen his tie.
Maybe I should broaden my preferences in men. He looks older than my peers. I think we have an age difference of about 10 years.
Diana thought to herself as she looked at Herman. Herman finally reached the cafe where he had arranged to meet Agatha. He began to look for the girl with his eyes. Agatha was not sitting alone at the far table in the corner. Her childhood friend Bert was sitting opposite her.
I'm not socializing with that guy for a slightly different reason.
Agatha began to gradually lead Bert to the topic of conversation she was interested in. To be honest, I'm even glad you two aren't in contact. When I first saw you two together, I thought you and him were a little incompatible. It seemed like your boyfriend was doing something he didn't want to do at all. Unexpectedly, Bert said to the girl. Agatha involuntarily pounded her fists on the table. Bert was getting annoyed with her. She wanted to talk to him about them, but he was talking about distractions.
I apologize if I touched on a sore subject. Speaking of desserts, I like this cake.
And since you're so interested, I'll give it to you, said Bert and handed the girl a piece of cake.
I've already told you a lot about your boyfriend, even though I don't even know anything about your relationship.
Please don't mention it to him, asked Bert. Herman sat at the next table and listened to the cooing of two childhood friends. He was angry with himself for having skipped lunch for this and for running all the way here. It seemed to Herman that the two of them were getting along quite well. I wonder why Agatha is afraid to tell the truth.
Suddenly, Agatha noticed Principal Gerbent at the next table. He looked extremely annoyed.
And why have you turned so dramatically pale? If you don't like it here, I can offer you another place, said Bert to the girl.
Thanks for buying me dessert, but I totally forgot I had things to do. I'll see you next time, said Agatha, jumping up from her seat. Without looking around, the girl rushed towards the exit.
I guess I was too pushy today, so I scared her away,
Bert thought to himself as he watched the girl run away.
In the hallway of the cafe,
Agatha unexpectedly bumped into Principal Gerbent.
"Now you'll have to talk to me," whispered Herman in the ear of the frightened girl.
"I apologize to you for asking you to clear up a misunderstanding and then changing my mind halfway through. I still had the nerve to come to your house and ask for it."
Startled, Agatha flew by.
She figured out for herself what I wanted to tell her. But why does she look so frightened? Do I frighten her with my appearance?
Thought to himself Herman. Herman himself did not understand why he was so angry with the girl. In fact, nothing much had happened. Yes, she had asked him for help, but she had promised nothing in return.
"Anyway, your laptop is fixed, so you can continue with your manuscript.
By the way, you know your makeup doesn't match the clothes you're wearing now, right?" Herman asked unexpectedly.
"Would you like me to go shopping with you and help you pick out some new clothes?"
Herman guessed that Agatha probably only had clothes of that cut in her closet. She wasn't used to looking feminine. Agatha spotted Bert at the end of the corridor. The girl hurried to push Herman around the corner.
"Be quiet and don't say anything. Bert is coming down the hall now. I don't want him to see us together."
Agatha hurriedly covered Herman's mouth with her hand.
"Well, didn't you want to tell him about our real relationship?" Herman asked the girl in a whisper.
"I apologize for being weird, but I don't want to explain anything to him at the moment. I have my own reasons for doing so. Please stay here for a while."
Agatha didn't want to admit to Herman that she was satisfied with her relationship with Bert for the moment. It was hard for Agatha to concentrate on her work. For the last few days, she had been thinking about Herman. He had opened up to her from a different angle. First, he had repaired her laptop, and second, he had already helped her several times.
"And yet I can feel that he's angry with me, but I don't know why. And I can't ask him what he's angry about because he won't tell me."
The next day, Agatha stalled on the moment where the protagonist embraced his beloved. The girl could not find the words to describe their tender touch beautifully.
Suddenly, a picture of Herman touching her in the corridor of the cafe came to Agatha's mind. At that moment, her heart was beating fast. How could she put these feelings on paper?
"And what are you doing now?" asked Bert, who had sprung up beside the girl. Agatha cried out in surprise and jerked backward. Bert picked her up so she wouldn't accidentally tip over with her desk chair.
"And what are you doing in my house?" Agatha wondered. Bert told her that her mother had let him into the apartment. He had come to borrow a book.
"If you don't want to hand it to me, I can read it here," said Bert, taking a seat on the floor next to Agatha's desk.
Agatha thought that if Bert was sitting next to her, she wouldn't be able to concentrate on her work. The girl decided to ignore Bert so that the guy would get bored and go home. A while later, Bert offered to order food delivery as he was getting very hungry. Agatha remembered that she had a piece of cake in the refrigerator, so the girl hurried to bring it to Bert. Bert ate the cake with great relish. It seemed that the boy was really happy. Agatha enjoyed watching him. She was glad that she had been able to talk to Bert in the cafe about his favorite desserts.
"I like desserts, so I always have sweets in my fridge. It's a little weird going to cafes alone, so I have to eat cakes and pastries at home," playing with a curl coquettishly, Agatha said.
The girl wanted to continue the conversation, but Bert was distracted by his phone.
"If you think about it that way, Bert's pretty shy. If I asked him out on a date, he might turn me down. Still, it's a good thing he didn't finish listening to me and got distracted by his phone. He needs to be handled more carefully," Agatha thought to herself as she watched Bert.
"So what was it you were telling me about the cafe?" asked Agatha Bert as he sent the last message.
"I was going to buy a gift for someone, and I wanted to go to a cafe afterwards. I have a lot of friends, and the gift I want to buy is for a man, so I need your help. Can you go shopping with me?" asked Agatha.
Agatha put on her newly bought clothes. The girl hoped that today would be the turning point for a long, unrequited love. Agatha planned to ask Bert to choose a tie, and why give it to him as a present? Agatha also planned to go with Bert to a cafe after the shopping trip and eat some delicious desserts. There, she wanted to speak for her other self. All of Agatha's plans fell apart after Bert came to her meeting with Diana. The guy decided that Diana would be a great assistant in choosing a gift for a man.
"My feet hurt so bad, I thought I was going to die.
When Bert said we'd go shopping, I never thought we'd be helping Agatha pick out a present, Diana confessed. I just thought the more discerning eyes, the better. And I liked everything in general. I suggest getting as much food and desserts as possible. With a smile on his face, Bert said, And I actually think that since we helped Agatha pick out a gift, she should buy us food now, Diana exclaimed. And you still haven't told us who you're going to give that tie to. It's my father's birthday soon, so this tie I'm giving him. Agatha lied. No, there's something you're not telling us. Your father is already a man of age, and you bought a tie more suited to the style of a young man. Did you get a boyfriend in your office? Diana asked. By the way, I was told that last time you left early because a man in a car came to pick you up. They say you and he have a slight age difference. Is all this true? Diana and Bert looked at Agatha suspiciously. That's not my boyfriend. He's the director of a publishing company, and he stopped by to discuss business matters. His face may look a little intimidating, but he's actually very nice, and I don't like what you're saying about him, Agatha exclaimed with irritation in her voice. This is the first time I've ever heard you talk about someone so much, and since you're not comfortable with it, we won't talk about it anymore. I suggest we get out of here somewhere else altogether, said Bert. To tell you the truth, I agreed to come here to help you get a change of scenery. Agatha, your mom is worried about you. She feels like you don't have any friends at all. Lately, you've been sitting at home all the time writing your books. And I called Diana with me so that you two can become closer to each other and find common ground. I really want you to become friends. Agatha, I don't understand you at all. Why were you sullen the whole time we were out picking out a tie? I try to be your friend, but you push me away. And, to be honest, I don't want to worry about you anymore. Embarrassed, Bert confessed to the girl. It had been several days since the last interaction with Bert. The guy was resentful of Agatha, so he avoided her. Because of the mental torment, it was hard for Agatha to concentrate on writing a new book. In order to have some fun, she went to a restaurant. Agatha ordered herself an iced mango and some ice cream. It was supposed to lift her spirits. Looking around, Agatha noticed that everyone in this restaurant was seated in pairs. It was probably used for blind dates. Darren invited his friend Herman to a restaurant. He had some problems he wanted to discuss with his buddy. Thank you for responding to my request and coming to meet me. By the way, could you do one more thing for me that I would be very grateful for? We'll have another person join us later, said Darren. Agatha watched couples in love. In this way, she wanted to find inspiration for a new book. Some couples fought, others reconciled, and still others were estranged. It's still great that I came here. I've already come up with several chapters and storylines for my novel. There are so many sources of inspiration everywhere. Agatha mentally complimented herself on her cleverness. Agatha saw two men enter the restaurant and sit at the farthest table. They were talking excitedly about something. No matter how much you try to resist, you'll still end up getting married because of your mother. So why don't you want to help me? It'll be good for both of us, shouted Darren, jumping up from his seat. And yes, you're right. She's here. The girl I'm setting you up on a blind date with right now. Could you please be a little quieter? There are people around us. They're already squinting at us, Herman hissed angrily. Looking around, he noticed a lonely red-haired girl sitting alone. She looked familiar to him. Didn't expect to meet a familiar face here, said Herman as he approached Agatha. I'm sorry, but I can't help you. I'm meeting this girl here tonight, said Herman to his buddy. He decided to take advantage of Agatha's malleability again. This girl would help him avoid an unnecessary blind date. Herman took Agatha's hand and led her out of the restaurant. Agatha groaned and stopped abruptly. She was wearing new shoes, so it was hard for her to keep up with Herman's quick stride. What's wrong? Are you all right? Herman asked the girl. Just a few seconds ago, I was in a restaurant and getting myself in the mood, but suddenly you show up. It's awkward when you show up out of nowhere and bring me into your conversation and then pull me out of it. Agatha was indignant. I'm sorry I spoiled your evening, replied Herman to the girl.
The man realized that he had embarrassed Agatha again. It was wrong to use her for his own selfish purposes. To make amends, Herman went to a nearby store and bought many different sweets for the girl. All I can tell you is that I'm sorry I dragged you into my affairs again. You see, at my age, the people around me look upon my loneliness as something abnormal, explained Herman to the girl. I want to confess something to you, too. I went to that restaurant today, not to get inspiration, but to calm myself down. It wasn't until later that I realized there were a lot of people in the restaurant to watch. Embarrassed, the girl confessed. So, after hearing him say that to me, I couldn't concentrate on the novel anymore, so I came here to cheer myself up. Agatha decided to tell Herman about her last conversation with Bert. It's my fault. I should have talked to him in person a long time ago about my feelings and experiences. It's probably too late to say anything now, Agatha said with a sigh. Looking at the girl, Herman worried that under the pressure of negative emotions, she would give up writing altogether. This cannot be allowed, because her books are in great demand. This girl is profitable for his company. I don't know if this will make you feel better or not, but if a guy isn't interested in a girl, he won't try so hard to help her. If you keep doing what you're doing now, I'm sure he'll continue to socialize with you. Herman tried to reassure the girl. By the way, I didn't want to tell you this, but I guess I'll have to. I overheard your conversation with Bert since I was in that cafe that day. I was out to lunch, so I overheard you two talking, and I remember you were talking about me. You know, it was nice to hear you say nice things about me, Herman whispered in the girl's ear. Agatha suddenly realized that her heart was also pounding frantically like last time. She wondered why she was reacting this way to Principal Gerbent. Looking into Herman's eyes, Agatha realized that she liked this man more and more every day. He makes her heart flutter. She feels different around Bert. She began to like the negative protagonists more than the positive ones.